my God can do anything.
Your thing.
Yes, yes.
My God can do anything, anything, anything. Oh, my God. Oh, no, no, no.
Anyone else need anything from God? Now's the time to get in while the waters is troubled. Glory.
My God can do anything. 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 My God can do anything. Yes, He can. He made this earth with all its fullness. He made all that time shall bring. Oh, my God. Can do anything. Anything. My God can do anything. 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 My God can do. Oh, yes. He made this whole earth. Yes. Earth with all its fullness. He made all that time shall bring. Oh, yes, He can do anything. Oh, anything. My God can do anything. 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 Oh, yes. My God can do anything. He made this earth with all its fullness. He made all that time shall bring. Oh, my God. Yes, He can do anything. Only believe.
Together and believe.
Yes. Only believe.
My
possible. Only believe. Yes. Only believe. Oh, yes. Only believe. All things are possible. Yes. Only believe.
To God. Anyone else need anything from God tonight? Glory be to God. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Glory be to God. Amen. Glory to God. God's in the house. Amen. Glory be to God. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. I've got an offering check somewhere. Your ushers are coming tonight to receive your tithes and your offering. Give and worship to God. Amen. God is certainly worthy of praise and of honor and of glory. Amen? And I'm so glad that we're able to come to the house of God and to worship with the singing, lifting of hands, and of giving back to God. Amen? You know, it's wonderful that God only asks a portion of what we have to be given back to Him. And I'm so delighted and honored that we're able to have that opportunity. Amen? Glory be to God. Dear Heavenly Father, as we come to you again today, we want to thank you for the blessings that you've given us. Thank you for this opportunity that you've allowed us to come into your house to worship in our giving. And tonight, Father, as we place our tithes and our offering into these offering plates, we ask you to let it go forth for the building and the spreading of the gospel of Jesus Christ. Multiply it to meet the need. Your Son's precious and holy name we pray. Amen and amen.
Seated while we sing the next song. Now, some of us may be a little tired, and some of us may be healed.
Yes, glory to God.
Hallelujah. You can just give God credit and praise, because that's part of the healing process.
Right,
praising the Lord for your healing, and constantly praise Him and keep praising Him. Some folks say the devil might try to steal your healing away. Well, the way to keep
on 267 in the same book, Hymns of the Spirit. And the name of it is, Jesus Will Hear Me When I Pray. Doubting not. Don't ever doubt it. You got to believe it. You can't mix faith and doubt. You got to have faith. Have faith in God. So let's sing this song, Jesus Will Hear Me When I Pray, 267. Ready?
When I'm tried on every hand, there is one who understands. Jesus will hear me when I pray. Victory is just ahead.
Everything's positive tonight, but the name of this song is Yes, God is Able.
That's right, amen.
He's able to meet your need tonight. I know if I said, how many have a need in your life? This right arm, it just automatically goes up. But sometimes we need to think about that need and have faith and set our faith together and get that need met. Yes, God is able. Let's sing this song. This will be our last one to sing.
If God could speak and bring the world into existence, if He could make the light to shine where all was dim, if He designed and put the universe in motion, then surely there is not a thing too hard for Him. Yes, God is able to do whatsoever we ask in the name of.
If He could cause their clothes to never wear away.
earth could send down fire to burn up on the altar. This sounds like a sermon here tonight.
If it could stop the rain from falling from the sky.
If God could cause a man to prophesy the future, then surely he's the one on whom we should rely. Yes, God is able.
Glory be to God. Amen. Again, we appreciate you being in service with us this evening. Amen. I know God is able to move and God's able to minister. Amen. And I'm so glad to be able to come back into the house of God. We may be physically tired, but we are still glad to be in the house of God. Amen. Glory be to God. If you have your Bibles, if you will, turn with us. We're going to be looking still in the book of John, chapter 17. The book of John, chapter 17. And tonight is, this evening, we are wrapping down, if you want to call it that. We're ending, we're finalizing, what I don't know what you want to call it. Sermon series that we've been talking on for the last several Sunday mornings, Sunday nights, and over the last several weeks that we've been looking at this, is prayer matters. Prayer makes the difference. Amen. Over the course of these last, it started on January the 22nd. You know, God has allowed us the opportunity, I guess is a good way of wording that, of doing several series. Is that the right word? I don't know. Multiple series. Sermon series, whatever the terminology is supposed to be. God has allowed us that opportunity to do those several times throughout our ministry. And one of the saddest parts of a series is the last one, the last service or the last sermon in that series. And the reason it is because I don't know how to end it. I don't know how to tie it all together. That's one thing that is just very hard to do, is to put everything, because I want to, I want to just keep going. I want to talk some more about it. We know that it's time to end this series that we've been talking about. We've been looking at a John chapter 17, verses 1 through 26. No, we have not spent a lot of time on every individual verse. We've grouped several verses together, and we've looked at different portions of the scripture, and we've pulled nuggets out of each of these sections of scripture, and that's what we've brought a sermon on. And so we go back to January the 22nd, that Sunday. We talked about how God is close to all of them who call on Him in truth. This is something that we must understand, is we have got to call on God in truth. God knows when you're truthfully calling on Him or when you're putting on a show. You understand? God knows when you're calling on God in a truth and when you're putting on a show. Do you remember in the Word of God, do you remember the Sadducees and the Pharisees and all of those E's, and how that they would stand over in the corner and they would lament and they would cry out and they would, I can just sort of visualize it in my mind, how that they would stand over there, Brother Stewart, and they would just sort of, nobody's watching me yet. Come on, watch me. Oh, God. Yeah, somebody's watching me now. They was wanting attention. They was wanting people to watch them, and they wanted people to,
oh, they must be really crying out to God. They must really be needing something from God. When all it really was is they was needing attention. God is close to them who call out on Him in truth. And that has been, I think, a big key on prayer matters. Prayer makes a difference, and it's all in how you pray to God. Amen? The Lord hears the cries of those who fear Him and rescues them in time of their need. He knows what you're needing before you ask, so why tiptoe around about it? Why try to hide it and disguise what you're needing from God? Why not just go ahead and lay it down at the altar and give it to God and let God move in your life? Amen. A lot of times, I know that there's people in their Christian walk with God, and they really don't want God to know how bad they've got it, or they've got it in their mind. They really don't want God to know how bad they think they've got it. Why? Because they either one of the concepts that they may have is, well, somebody needs God more than I do, and I don't want to distract God. Oh, come on. I know y'all know people that's thought that, and I know nobody in here's ever thought that. But here's the fact that we've got to understand. God cares about your needs just as much as He cares about somebody else's need. Just go ahead and lay it down at the foot of the cross and let God move and let God work and leave everything else to God. Amen? We just need to take it to God and leave it there. Amen? We looked at John chapter 17, and this is Jesus Christ's prayer. This is His prayer. This is the prayer that Christ prayed out to God. Amen. And one of the things that we've seen in this passage of Scripture is that the church has got to get its priorities in order. That's been one key that we've looked at every service, is that the church has got to get our priorities in order. We've got to quit trying to figure out who thinks they're going to do better than me, who's going to one-up me, who's going to do this. We've got to get our priorities in order. What does our priorities need to be? Find out what was important to Christ and get a hold of that. What was important to Christ? The church. Lost souls getting saved. Let me rest you assured, it wasn't how many points you made on your Bejeweled game. If you don't know what Bejeweled is, I'll show you after church. It wasn't whether or not you could make the high score on whatever game you play on your phone, because nobody plays games during church on their phones. Don't worry, I've caught some of you. Oh, I haven't seen anybody. Here's the fact of the matter that we've got to get in our mindset, is get our priorities in order and let God take care of everything else. Amen? When we get our priorities in order, when we get our desires and what we want in our lives, when we get that in tune with God, God will take care of everything. Brother Andy, that ain't in Scripture. Matthew chapter 6 and verse 33, seek ye first the kingdom of God and His righteousness, and all these things shall be added unto you. Amen? What we've got to get in our mindset is simply this. We seek after God, God will take care of the details. Amen? Glory be to God. God, Jesus Christ, is the great intercessor. What we've got to understand is we have got to pray and get a hold of God for what was important in His life. Amen? What was important to Christ? Lost souls getting saved. The church getting closer to Him. Amen? There are 650 prayers recorded in the Word of God. None of them can compare to the high priestly prayer that's found here in John chapter 17. Amen. We also looked at January the 29th. We looked at verse 1, and we seen here that Jesus is wanting to teach us how to pray. We see in John chapter 17, verse 1, he lifted his eyes to heaven. Luke 11 and 1 says, the disciples said, Lord, teach us to pray. Amen. One of the big things that we learned on that particular date of January 29th, one of the things we learned is our posture is not as important as the content in which we pray. There are folks that lays prostrate before God. That's all more power to them. I can't do that. I can't get back up very easy. There are some folks that kneel down on their knees before God. There's some folks that sits down before God. Then there's folks like me that walks around all over the place. I'm so glad that God does not get seasick watching me walk. That's how I feel. That's how I pray. Is I come up here, y'all, I've come up here before, and I'll sit over here, and I'll get up, and I'll walk around a little bit, and I may sit over here on this pew, and I'll get up and walk around a little bit, and I'll sit over here for a little bit. I walk around and pray. I'm trying to find the area, y'all, this is not, I'm trying to find where am I going to get closer to God at. Is it right here, or is it back yonder? No, that's not what I'm doing. I want to get a hold of God. And I don't want anything else distracting. I don't want anything else hindering what we're doing. Some people are so concerned about their posture in prayer. It's more important about the posture of your heart. When was the last time your heart got on its knees before God? When was the last time your heart laid prostrate before God and got a hold of God? And not this now I lay me down to sleep business. Amen. Glory be to God. What we've got to understand is throughout the Word of God, we see different ones. Some people bowed on their knees, as found in Genesis 24 and 2 Chronicles 20 and Ephesians 3. We see that Jesus bowed on his knees in Luke 22. Jesus also fell on his face in Matthew 26. David kneeled in Daniel chapter 6. Daniel kneeled in Daniel chapter 6. King David sat down in 2 Samuel. Abraham stood in Genesis 18. The importance is, are we getting a hold of God? We also seen on February the 5th that there was three remarkable gifts that were given because we go to God in prayer. First of all, the Father gives the authority. The second thing that we seen is God gave the people to the Son of God. Then the final thing that we see is the Son of God gives eternal life to those that are given to Him. So we know that we're given to the Son, and guess what? The Son is giving eternal life to those that get a hold of God. Amen. What we've got to get in our mindset is every one of us has got eternal life. The question is not whether or not you got eternal life. You got it. Where are you going to spend it? That's the key. That's the point you got to get a hold of. Christ came that you could have eternal life and you would have that life and have it more abundantly. Christ came so that you could have eternal life, and one day is going to come. You're going to cross over Jordan and you're going to spend the rest of it in heaven, or are you going to spend it in hell? The question is, are you going to get a hold of the eternal life that Christ wants you to have? Amen. The next thing that we seen was in February, was on February chapter February chapter 12. I know no minister in here has ever done that before. On February the 12th, we've seen the dynamics of discipleship. The word disciple is found 264 times in the New Testament, in Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, and in the book of Acts. The word disciple, it means simply this. A true disciple is not just a student who learns, but a one that actually learns and does what he's learned and then puts into practice what he's learned. It's time that the church quit just listening and start putting into practice what we've listened to. We've got to apply it to our lives. It's time that the church quit having a bunch of seers and actually start having some doers. Amen. So we belong to the Father. We got to be a disciple of Jesus Christ. Amen. So we also seen that on March the 5th, which is where we're at today, the question that I want to ask you is just wrapping all this down, tying it up in a nice, neat bow. Is Christians, are we united or are we untied? Christians, are we united or are we untied? I want you to look here in John chapter 17. I want you to look at verses 20 through 24. If you will, turn in your Bibles to John 17, 20 through 24. John 17, 20 through 24. Look at what it says, starting in verse 20. It says this: I do not ask for these only, but also for those who will believe in me through their word, that they may all be one. Look at that word one, O-N-E. That they may all be one, just as you, Father, are in me and I in you. That they may also be in us, so that the world may believe that you have sent me. The glory, that's another word we're going to look at, glory. The glory that you have given me, I have given to them, that they may be one, even as we are one. Have you seen the word one anymore? I in them and you in me, that they may become perfectly one, so that the world may know that you sent me and loved them even as you loved me. Father, I desire that they also whom you have given me be with me where I am, to see my glory that you have given me, because you have loved me before the foundation of the world. Dear Heavenly Father, as we come to you again this afternoon, Father, I praise you for the blessings that you've given us. We praise you for just a wonderful day that we've had in your presence. Father, for the next few moments, as we're bringing forth your word as you've given it to us, God, I pray right now that you'll hide us behind the cross of Calvary, that those looking would see your Son being high and lifted up, that all would be drawn unto you. We forever give you the praise, the honor, and the glory. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. Amen. We want to look at this. I know that there's a couple of more verses past this, but I want us to look at something here. In this closing paragraph, in this closing portion of this prayer, the Lord Jesus Christ emphasizes the matter of spiritual unity. Unity is something that has been mentioned before. You can go back to verse 11 and you can see this. But not only that, it is a burden of this prayer. Everybody's heard the slogan, "United we stand, divided we fall." How true that is. Everybody's heard the saying, this is also passages of Scripture, but everybody's heard the saying that a three-strand cord is not easily to be divided, it's not easily to be broke, it's not easy to be torn apart. You understand what I'm saying? And we bring this in, I've brought that in several times in weddings, how that you've got one, you got the husband, you got the wife, and you got God. You can have a husband and a wife, and that marriage can fall. I'm sorry, a husband and wife, if that's all that's in the marriage, it can fall. Amen? If that is the only two that's in the marriage, it can fall. You add the third cord, which would be God. You add Him into the equation, it's going to stand. Amen? If the husband and the wife, and you bring God into the mix, it can stand. Amen? If everybody gets a hold of God, it can stand. There's been several times that I've I've talked to couples before they got married, and we laugh, we talk. I know that just shocks you that I can talk with somebody and we laugh. But we'll laugh and we'll talk, and I'll never forget it. There was one time we were sitting at a restaurant. Surprise. I was going to try my best not to bring fruit into this tonight. We were sitting in a restaurant, and me and Sister Carrie were sitting on one side of the table, and the future bride and groom was sitting on the other side of the table, and we was just talking, and we was laughing and cutting up, and I said, I want to tell you something. I've got three things that if you'll follow these three things, every marriage will work if you'll follow these three things to a T. You should have seen his eyes. He was like, oh, give me a secret. Buddy, I ain't got no secrets. Number one is communication. Number two is communication. And number three is communication. Now he's got a look of puzzled on his face. Number one is communication, you to God. Number two, her to God. And number three, you to her. And that communication is a back and forth. It's not a one-way street. It's got to be both ways. And so I've explained that several times of how the... And Katie has probably heard it more than once, and that's just building it up for when she's 35 or 40. But the thing that we've got to understand is communication is a big key in every aspect of our lives. Amen? If you don't have communication, it's going to fall. Amen? And so we need communication between us and God. And we see here in this, John chapter 17, we see communication and we see unity between us and God is a key thing that God wants in our lives. If we don't have unity, we don't have anything. If we don't have unity, we've got discord. Do you know what God does not like? What God finds is something that's appalling? It's discord among the brethren. Amen? You want to throw discord. You want to throw an upheaval. You want to get God on your bad side. Or better, you on God's bad side. Start strowing discord. Amen? Now, let's look at this. I want us to look at something here. The burden of Christ's prayer is unity. We see in Psalms chapter 133 and verse 1, we see this. Behold how good and how pleasant it is for brothers to dwell together in unity. I remember growing up. Wait a minute. All you kids, close your ears. I remember growing up that if anything ever happened around the house, if me, my brother, and my sister was on the same page, it was so much easier, or so we thought, to pull the wool over mom and dad's eyes. We thought that it was easy to get away with anything if the three of us was on the same page. But since the fact of it was... my sister was just so mean to myself and my brother all of the time. We never stayed in a unified fashion in anything like that because my sister was so mean to us. Y'all don't ask her if I said that. But one thing that I want you to understand in all of this is simply this. When folks get together in unity, they almost can pull anything out. If I had a big rock sitting here in the middle of this floor, If I had a big rock, a big boulder sitting in the middle of this floor that weighed 1,500 pounds, if we all got on different sides and started all pushing at the same time, the boulder's not going anywhere. But if we all get on the same side and we all push together, or we get most on one side and some on another side, some are pushing and some are pulling a rope that's around the boulder, guess what? We're going to start making progress. We're going to start doing something. Why? Because we're in unity. Now, I know today we've got boats that's got motors on them, and you don't even have to pull a string. You can flip a switch, and some of them, they'll just start right up, and they'll take you all across the lake. They'll take you everywhere, and you can get wherever you need to go. You can go all these places. But if you'll go back and you'll remember, and it's even in the Olympics, they've got the rowboats. And if there's more than one person on that boat, they've got to be in unity, or they're going to just spin in circles. They're not going to go anywhere. I remember in history class that they was talking about how that these big massive sailboats and these big massive rowboats that you'd have 10 and 20 people down below deck, and they was all rowing. Well, they all had to row at the same time. They was in unity in order for the boat to make it from point A to point B. As a church, we have got to be in unity together. Amen. Let's look at this. I'm not going to be much longer, I promise you that. Only 3 more hours and we'll be good. Bible history and church history bear the record, and it's a sad face to know that believers, I know this is going to shock you, believers do not always get along with one another. Some people think that when they come to church that everybody in church is going to have a smile on their face and everybody's going to get along with one another in church. I'm going to go ahead and settle this right now. Some folks that'll hurt you are those that are in church worse than anybody else. Why are you bringing this out? Brother Andy, do you not realize that we're on live feed? Do you not want that not to be told to folks that's watching? No, I want you to understand something. And this is for anybody that may be watching this later on or watching this live. What we've got to understand is we're human. But if you allow something that goes on in the church to separate you from God, then it wasn't God that you was in church for. It was man. I'm not here for any other reason than to get along with God. Now, I want to be in unity one with another. And in order to do that, I got to make sure my relationship with God is right. There's many a times that whenever I've thought that I was in a disagreement or that somebody might be upset with me in church, that this is how I pray: God, change me. Change my outlook. Change my thought process. Change the way I see things. Spiritual unity is a rare commodity. No wonder the Lord has included it in His prayer for the church. Here's you something else that's just going to blow you out of the water. Disregarding doctrine. It makes me sad. Makes me very upset to see church folks that have such a high disregard for doctrine. I did not say denominational belief. I did not say the bylaws of the Church of God. Y'all don't tell the state office I said that. I said it is sad to see the number of church folks that has such a high disregard of doctrine. Doctrine is biblical. Hello? Doctrine is found in the Word of God. Doctrine is laying hands on the sick and they shall recover. Doctrine is calling for the elders of the church when we're sick. Doctrine is getting a hold of God when we need something in our lives. Doctrine is getting a hold of God when everything's going right. Doctrine is paying your tithes. Oh, I didn't know. It is sad that in the church world today we see such a high disregard for doctrine. We see such a high watering down of everything to the least common denominator. And that's not what Jesus had in mind. Doctrine is an essential part of unity. If we just allowed everybody to teach what they think, don't you know how such a messed up place the church would be? This one over here can teach however they want to teach, and this one over here can teach however they want to teach. This one says that tithing is not important. This one says tithing's important. This one back here says that laying hands on the sick is an outdated process. This one over here says we don't call for the elders of the church. Don't you see how much a disarray and unorganization that there would be? That's why there must be doctrine that we follow in the church. That's why we've got to follow the Word of God. It's not a matter, I've already said this and I've said this time and time again. When you get to heaven, it's not going to be what thus saith Brother Andy. You know, I wonder how many folks are going to say what thus saith you, Pastor. Brother Stewart, they some folks, they might be sad, you reckon? They get to heaven, they say, but Pastor Stewart said. It don't matter, does it? It's what thus saith God. What thus saith the Word of God. Amen. It's not what I've said. It's what God. What did God say? Do you know how many times that I've had to, that I've studied and I've had to go to God and I've said, okay, God, I've got to, you've got to touch me in my life in this area before I get up and preach it. Hello? I know this is going to shock you, but I'm not perfect. Not perfect. I still have to go to God daily. I still have to get on my knees before God. I still have to say, God, forgive me. Work in an area in my life. Doctrine is important. Doctrine is an essential part of unity. There is not only one Lord, but there's one faith, Ephesians 4 and 5, and we are content to contend earnestly for the faith, which was once for all delivered to the saints, Jude chapter 3. Our Lord, wrapping down, just a few more moments, I promise you. Our Lord gives us encouragement for spiritual unity by reminding us of the bonds that tie us together. First of all, we trust in the same Savior. One Jesus Christ, and that's it. There's not three Jesuses, there's one Jesus. The gift of eternal life comes through knowing God, through our faith in Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ is the only Savior, and because Jesus Christ is the Son of God. Something else is important, the work of Jesus on the cross. So many times today, people want to diminish the work of Jesus on the cross. Why? Because we don't want to teach our kids about the blood of Christ. That might offend them. That might upset them. It's time that some folks got offended about the blood of Christ. Amen? It was time. It's time that some folks got all upset over the blood of Christ. Why? He needs to change their lives. The second thing is we bear the same witness to the world. Twice in this prayer, Jesus mentions the church's witness to the lost world. If you claim to be a Christian, you're the same witness as somebody else that claims to be a Christian. You may have gone through different things, and this is what we've got to understand. If I say I'm a Christian, and I'm a member of the Coosa Valley Church of God, and I treat somebody wrong and dirty and ugly, the next time when Brother Hank comes around and he says, I'm a member of the Coosa Valley Church of God, what are they going to think? They're not worried about what he's doing right now. All that's on their mind is what I did to them then. We've got to understand this. We're all the same witness. The last thing is we all share the same glory. This is something that's very important in our lives. It's not a matter of, do I get a pat on my back for doing something? It's not a matter of, do I get props for doing what I'm doing? It's not a matter, do I get credit? We're all under the glory of God. It's not a matter of, do I get credit? It's does he get credit? It's not a matter, am I going to get honor? It's, does he get the honor? Amen? It's not about us. It's all about him. And I'm telling you, prayer does matter. Would you stand tonight? We all share in the same glory. Each individual Christian is God's temple. What a difference it would make in our personal relationships with other believers if we would try to look beyond just what's right here and remember we all share the same glory within. This afternoon, I know that we have had an awesome service, and we've already had altar service tonight. We're fixing to pray. If you need something from God, I want you to understand, God is able to move in your life. God's able to minister in your heart and in your life today. Dear Heavenly Father, as we come to you again today, we want to thank you. We thank you for the blessings that you've given us. We thank you for this opportunity that you've allowed us to come and to worship and praise you. What an honor and a privilege it has been and it is to be in your house. Tonight, as your word has gone forth and as your word has gone forth over the last several weeks, Father, on prayer matters. God, I'm praying right now that your words and that this word from your holy word of God, that the words would resonate into our hearts and our lives. God, I pray that the seed has been planted and it would produce good fruit. We forever give you the praise, the honor, and the glory in Jesus' name. You know, the thing about it is, church, God has moved around Coosa Valley. Today is March the 5th, and in just 13